Today I want to talk to you about, I know this is a crazy title, but it's called Preparation H, H for Harlotin. What is God preparing for us in Harlotin? I won't say much more about the title, but the subtitle is called A Tsunami Deluge. So I've been talking about how the Lord, I feel like, is doing a deluge of stuff. This last week, I don't know if any of you heard about this, but on Monday, October 19th, around 1 p.m. local time, a large 7.5 magnitude earthquake hit near the Alaskan Peninsula. As a result, there was a tsunami warning triggered for that area, because obviously, if you know a little bit about Alaska, the southern part of Alaska, that's a lot of islands and water. Now, fortunately, that tsunami warning did not turn into much, just very small waves that came out of it. But when a massive shaking takes place in an area near water, oftentimes a tsunami is triggered. If you don't know what a tsunami is like a tidal wave, a big wall of water that comes as a result of these movings and shakings. It's a deluge of water that sweeps over an area, sometimes small, sometimes large. Okay. In this case, I guess the waves were as high as 4.5 feet tall or less in this particular one in Alaska. It was mild, but sometimes a tsunami is large and devastating. I did some studying. How many of you remember the 2005 Indian Ocean tsunami? Does anybody here remember that? Okay. It was in the southern part of Asia in the Indian Ocean. A massive underwater earthquake off the west coast of Indonesia. According to estimates, the earthquake itself was between 9.1 and 9.3 on the Richter scale, and it lasted between 8 to 10 minutes. And it triggered a massive wave of tsunamis that swept across the area. The force was so strong that it was said to be equal to 23,000 atomic bombs when the earthquake hit. The waves that were created reached as high as 100 feet tall and impacted nations all around that quake area. After all was said and done, best estimates put the loss of life at nearly 230,000 people from 14 countries, making it one of the deadliest natural disasters in recorded history. The damage done to structures was hard to measure, but entire areas were wiped out, including villages, tourist resorts, farmland, fishing grounds that were demolished or contaminated. In Indonesia alone, more than 500,000 houses were washed away in this tsunami. Over $14 billion in donations came in to help with the rescue and rebuild efforts, and I don't think they even know the exact damages. It was something that impacted not only Asia and the surrounding area, but it impacted the world. In fact, the earthquake itself is reported to have raised the floor of the ocean nearly 40 meters or 131 feet and caused a shift in the Earth's mass that changed the planet's rotation. Did you catch that? It changed the planet's rotation. Even in North Dakota, the church I was a part of there was impacted by this. There was a building downtown that was owned by somebody that was in the area at the time. The person who owned it was actually down in Asia, they believe, at the time of the tsunami, and he was never heard from again after the tsunami. And so the property he owned eventually became a youth center and was held in limbo due to taxes for years because they couldn't find the owner. I want to show you now, these are some of the pictures of the damage from the tsunami. I want to show you a video quick now, which is a recreation from a Hollywood movie called The Impossible. And this is kind of what the tsunami would have looked like when it came into a resort. Crazy. Why am I sharing about this great tsunami in the Indian Ocean? Because a tsunami is a perfect example of a deluge that affects so many people. And I believe that God has laid on my heart that picture to illustrate what is taking place in so many areas of the world right now. There is a spiritual tsunami impacting people all over this area and all over the world. It's literally coming in and it's sweeping through. And I want you to understand what God is doing through it. The spiritual tsunami has a different purpose than a natural one. A natural one generally destroys everything. But a spiritual tsunami is a little different. Let me start by sharing with you the results of a spiritual tsunami. First off, let me understand a little bit behind a spiritual tsunami. God has a greater purpose behind a spiritual tsunami than what we see in the natural. God is found in the midst of divine chaos. The enemy in our world is trying to send pandemonium and a pandemic of chaos over the whole world. God is releasing divine pandemonium and panic, however, into the spiritual realms of darkness. What we see in the physical, God is doing to the enemy in the spiritual. God is accomplishing things in a short amount of time that couldn't be done any other way. If you were to ask any of us probably a year ago if it was possible for some of the things that we are experiencing right now to take place, we would have said, there's no way. But God has a purpose and a plan through all of this. When God is in control, we do not have to fear. We just get to ride the wave. Psalm 46 verses 1 and 2 gives us a good idea of what we should have for an attitude. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Even if there is a tsunami of things going on around us, we do not have to fear. Even if the earth gave way and the mountains fell. So the result of a spiritual tsunami, first off, and I believe the Lord's laid these things on my heart, is number one, a cleaning, or letter A, if you're taking notes. A spiritual tsunami often brings about cleaning and purification. Picture what a tsunami does to an area. When a massive wave comes in, it moves and removes almost everything in its path, right? Just like the picture of the video I showed you. And when it is gone, it looks like a mess at first. But it actually cleans and removes everything that was there. Our world and many of our lives seem a mess and filled with debris everywhere. Debris of past damage that's strewn about, debris of lost jobs or income, debris of sickness and death perhaps, debris of uncertainty and unfamiliarity. And in the midst of all of this, you may feel unstable. You may feel like the ground has shaken and the waves have crashed in and everything is different. And things don't look the same. And although it may be a little scary and you may feel uncertain, realize God is doing a spiritual cleaning. The spiritual waters are there to purify. God is cleaning up and clearing out before he rebuilds. Let me say that again. God is cleaning up and clearing out before he rebuilds. Now, I'm not saying that everything that takes place right now is God's doing, but what I'm saying is God uses and does things that we don't always understand. God is destroying man-made structures that need to be removed so God can rebuild it the right way. Maybe they were useful in their time, but not anymore. God is clearing out filth and sin. God is wiping the slate clean in many areas and in many ways. The old is not coming back, whether we like it or not. Just like a tsunami comes in and changes the landscape, the spiritual tsunami is changing our landscape because God has something new. And in order to do that, there has to be a massive cleaning. Listen to what Isaiah chapter 24, verses 18 and 19 tells us. It gives us a great picture of what I believe God is doing. It says, whoever flees at the sound of terror will fall into a pit. Whoever climbs out of the pit will be caught in a snare. Now listen to this last part. The floodgates of the heavens are opened. The foundations of the earth shake. The earth is broken up. The earth is split asunder. The earth is thoroughly shaken. Does that sound a little bit like what's taking place right now? Listen to this prophetic word from a man named Jeremiah Johnson. Some of you may have heard of him. This prophetic word came in July, and I came across this. Let's show a picture of this Lady of Liberty, and you'll understand this vision next. This is what he said in this. Lady of Liberty, he said, in my dream last night, I found myself on a concrete platform directly underneath the face of Lady Liberty in New York, which is a Statue of Liberty. And he says, this picture I found on the internet is exactly how it was in my dream. I knew the rest of her body was underwater because I was on an elevated place and the floodwaters had risen all around me. However, I felt strongly safe and secure where I was directly below her face. As I looked out at the waves and water all around me that were surrounding Lady Liberty, I saw hundreds of arcs like Noah's Ark floating in the water. Each arc had the remnant painted upon their sides and were flying two flags. One was an American flag and the other was an appeal to heaven flag. I started shouting in the dream to those on the boats. There is a two-part warning and encouragement for all that have eyes to see and ears to hear. The first is a warning to America. Number one, Lady Liberty is up to her neck in the floodwaters of destruction that represent tyranny, anarchy, and a demonic agenda that seeks to destroy the freedoms that this great nation was founded upon. If you do not rise up in this hour and fight for your liberties, they will be taken away for far sooner than you ever realized. As I shouted this, there was an ear-piercing alarm that went off all over America that specifically shook California. I continued. Number two, the second part is a word of encouragement. Lady Liberty is not underwater yet, and the fire in her right hand has not gone out. There is a mighty end-time revival that is coming to a remnant in America who will not live in fear and will speak up at all costs. As I finished my proclamation, the remnant began to roar on their arcs that were floating, and the floodwaters immediately began to recede. The louder they got, the quicker the floodwaters disappeared. I suddenly awakened from the dream, and Proverbs 14:34 was on my lips. It says, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And then he has this disclaimer. I do not believe that this prophetic dream is literal, meaning there is a real flood coming to New York City that will bring physical destruction, etc. I also believe that there could be multiple interpretations to this dream. What I have shared is what was revealed to me by the Spirit and what I specifically said in the prophetic dream and wrote down upon waking up. And then he says, let the remnant arise, Jeremiah Johnson. Now, why do I share that? Whenever you hear a prophetic word like that, you have to judge it. Is this from God? Does that fit what I feel like God's saying right now? Don't take it and run with it and make stuff up. But if that fits to what you feel like God's doing, then listen to it. I believe God is cleaning. I believe through all this, in the midst of the chaos and the shaking that the enemy is trying to do to our nation and world, God has a bigger and a greater plan. And how many of you know that God is greater and more powerful than what goes on in this world? The enemy is releasing havoc into the world, and God is turning it around and releasing havoc into the spiritual realms of evil. He is destroying and throwing into chaos the kingdom of darkness, God is. God is beginning to send shockwaves into the kingdom of darkness and wreaking havoc on the enemy's camp. The enemy is outmatched. God is releasing a tsunami of righteousness, prayer, power, and revival over the world. And as God's people, don't underestimate the power of what God is doing. There is a cleaning that is taking place, but we must allow God to use the spiritual tsunami to clean things up. We can't resist in our country, in our area, or in our lives. And here's the thing, when a tsunami comes in and cleans up, it will be messy. I guarantee it. It won't be easy. In fact, we think in our lives that revival, when we use that word, it's clean and pleasant and makes us feel good all the time. Sometimes revival is messy and dirty and chaotic at first. Until things get cleaned up, it may not be pretty. So here's my advice to you. Embrace the mess. Let God purify you, but embrace the mess. Let me read a word given by another prophetic group in Scotland. I told you that God is raising up prophets. I never used to listen to a lot of them much, but I feel like this is a season we're in. It says this, "You will see my justice come on the earth, and because you have let me do this purifying in your life, you will live in peace, confidence, and security in an undisturbed place of rest. Even when the rest of the world looks like it's falling apart, oh, how blessed you will be because I have prepared you." We need to embrace the mess because God is cleaning things up. Picture that tsunami in your mind. Let me tell you what else happens when a tsunami comes in. A resetting takes place. We've talked about this before in other contexts. I believe God is resetting so many things right now, and I'm just going to list a bunch of them very quickly. The things that I feel like God is resetting, you can agree with them or you can pray into them however you want, but I believe God is resetting church as usual. He's resetting ministry models and programs that we've done in the church to do what He wants to do. I believe God is resetting families and priorities. I believe God is resetting our dependence on self to a new focus on God and His power. See, we can't do it in ourselves anymore. We need Him. We need the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's why He sent, you know, Jesus came. He says, "It's good that I go, because if I don't go, you will not receive the Holy Spirit." We need the Holy Spirit. He is resetting passivity in the spiritual realm into a season of warfare and war. We can't just sit back and say, you know what, things, I hope they get better. We have to pray. We have to do our part and see what God has for us to do in the spiritual realm. How many of you believe in the power of prayer? Anybody here? Then pray, because you'll see God do miracles. He's also resetting us from ministering out of hurt to ministering out of health. No longer do we need to go, "Oh, I I've got some stuff in my life and I'm still going to try to help people." God's going to begin healing us so that we can heal others. He's resetting from compromise and lethargy to holiness and passion. We don't need to have compromise anymore. We need the holiness of God. We need passion, not just sitting by and getting by. He's resetting, I believe, the idea of perfect people ministering to those that have a passion and a zeal. You don't have to be perfect. You just have to be available and faithful to God. He is resetting ministry within the church building. You see, ministry used to happen mostly within the church building. I believe God is trying to move it out to the marketplace out there. I believe that for whatever reason, what we're doing out here is outside the church building. It's a picture of where God is trying to do with us. He is resetting my will to thy will. And He is resetting old wineskins to new wineskins. Put simply, He is resetting nations, communities, economies, power structures, assignments, directions, and lives. How many of you see that right now? It's all over us. You can't not see it. In the midst of this spiritual tsunami, things are getting reset. There is no going back. The tsunami is wiping out many things in the old, many of the things that needed to go because they were for the last season. Their time had passed. Now it's time to move forward. And then the third thing that is a result of the spiritual tsunami, number one is cleaning, number two is resetting, and number three is a surge of God's presence and power. That presence and power is over the enemy and over the lands and over the waters. There's a picture in Genesis 1:2 I felt like the Lord laid on my heart of creation. Here's what Genesis 1:2 says. Some of you have read this many times. It says, "The earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters." This is the picture of the beginning of times. Now, the word translated formless the earth was formless and empty, can also can mean confusion or emptiness. There was nothing. There was confusion. There was chaos. There was lack of order in the universe at this time. And God stepped in with his Spirit hovering over that environment, and he created something orderly and great. The verse before that says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. When God's creative power and presence shows up, it changes things from chaos to something wonderful and orderly. When there is a surge or a tsunami of God's presence and power, like in creation, it radically changes the reality of the situation. It goes from chaos to creation. It goes from nothing to something. When God hovers over a situation, it changes. Amen? God births out of chaos. Or in this particular case, God births light out of chaos, right after he said, and let there be light. I think it's a picture of the surge of God's presence and power that's taking place. So, if God wants to do all those things, what's the catalyst for a spiritual tsunami? Does it just happen on its own? Or are there things that we can do to help create that environment or to help speed it along or help it grow? Well, let me start by saying this. A tsunami is caused generally by something underwater or underground that causes movement, like an earthquake. Or an underwater volcano can also cause a tsunami. But spiritually, it works the same way. Something unseen or below the surface can create a tsunami, a spiritual tsunami. And the cause can be something destructive and sinister, like the enemy, or a volcano or an earthquake in the physical. Or it can be something good and godly in the spiritual realm. Let me talk about the good tsunamis and the sometimes hidden catalysts God uses to shake an area and bring about a spiritual tsunami that cleans and resets and surges God's presence and power. I think the first, and I talked about it a little bit earlier, is this. Prayer is a catalyst. Prayer is a catalyst. Jesus said that when we pray, we ought to go into a quiet place away from everybody and pray, and not so that everyone can see us. You see, it's often something behind the scenes that takes place. I bet if you could ask people who came to Jesus, who put their faith in Jesus, and I bet you will find a mom, a dad, a grandma, a grandpa, an aunt, or maybe all of the above that were praying for them prior to them giving their heart to Jesus. Because that prayer is a catalyst for things in the spiritual realm. There's an interesting story in the Old Testament of this catalyst of prayer. It's found in 1 Kings chapter 18, starting at verse 41, and I'm going to read it here in a second. It's a story where Israel was without rain for 3 years because somebody prayed. And it created a severe famine on the land, and the king was beside himself on what to do. And in this particular story, Elijah, the prophet of God, had just defeated the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. And God was about to do something. Let me read starting in verse 41 what took place. And Elijah said to Ahab, who was the king, "Go eat and drink, for there is the sound of a heavy rain." Now remember, it hadn't rained for 3 years. So Ahab went off to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed to the top of Mount Carmel, bent down to the ground, and put his face between his knees. "Go and look toward the sea," he told his servant, and he went up and looked. "There is nothing there," he said. "Seven times," Elijah said, "go back." The seventh time, the servant reported, "A cloud as small as a man's hand is rising from the sea." How many know that's a small cloud? But there was a cloud. So Elijah said to his servant, "Go and tell Ahab the king, Hitch up your chariot and go down before the rain stops you. Meanwhile, the sky grew black with clouds, the wind rose, a heavy rain came on, and Ahab rode off to Jezreel. The power of the Lord came upon Elijah, and tucking his cloak into his belt, he ran ahead of Ahab all the way to Jezreel. There's so much in the story we can talk about. Crying out to God in prayer is the simple part. There is power in prayer. In fact, in James 5, verses 17 and 18, it gives us a picture of this particular story. It tells us Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. A catalyst for a spiritual tsunami often starts with prayer. Crying out to God in prayer is powerful and effective. The verse right before this in James says, the prayer of a righteous man or woman is powerful and effective. Or the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. See, the catalyst for change in a spiritual tsunami here in Harlotin and other areas, I believe, is prayer. I believe some of you are praying. I believe we can all be praying. Plead for God for more of Him, for more revival, for more of whatever He has for us. Not for ourselves, but for God's will to be done. Prayer is a catalyst. By the way, here's three things that prayer does really quickly, and I'm not going to get into details, but prayer changes things, prayer changes people, and prayer moves heaven and earth. When you pray, it is powerful and effective because it changes things, it changes people, and it moves heaven and earth. Prayer is a catalyst. Let me go with another catalyst for you this morning. Passion is a catalyst. Have you ever been around somebody who's passionate about something? Who's really passionate about something? When I was, my wife and I were, this is probably 12 years ago, maybe 13 years ago. We had a pastor friend, and his wife came and preached at the church that we were at. And their name is Ken and Marilyn Ross. And some of you may know him. He was my pastor growing up in Haver. He pastored over in Helena First. But when they came over to Circle, we had them for dinner after the service, and they began to talk about this place called Israel. And they said, you need to go to Israel. It will change your life. And they got so passionate about it. They said how it changed their life. They began to say all the things that took place there. And guess what began to happen when they began to talk about that? We got to go to Israel. Long story short, God used their passion to be a catalyst to get us to go to Israel, and now we've been there twice. We took some of you there. Because the passion that they had rubbed off on us. There's an old song that went like this, "It only takes a spark to get the fire going," right? If you have passion and zeal for the things of God, you can be a catalyst for great things. I believe that's one of the reasons why God tells us in Romans 12:11, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Passion is often a catalyst for great things. Amen? Here's another thing that can be a catalyst, and I got two more. Pause can be a catalyst. Pause, another P word. How is pausing a catalyst? I think sometimes we get so focused on what we've always done and what we have in front of us that we lose sight of where we are going or what we need to do. Instead of reprioritizing or seeing what we need to do, maybe we have bad habits, maybe we have dug ourselves into a hole of busyness or complacency, but when we pause, we often reevaluate where we're at and what we're doing. It causes us to shift gears and go a different direction. How many of you have ever been on a vacation and you came back and you're going, man, it's time to make some changes because you paused for a minute. It's good and right to pause and wait upon the Lord so that you will have your strength renewed like the eagles. That's what Isaiah 40:31 says. When you pause, you may finally hear God's voice that you weren't hearing. You may find spiritual direction for your life or your situation. You may gain power, or you might simply remove yourself from a bad situation. Pause can be a great catalyst. That's why when our world has been put on pause, things are changing. When things go on as usual, we often don't take time to reflect, change, or fix what's broken. We just accept things the way they are or what we're comfortable with. Pause can be a catalyst. Let me say one more catalyst and then I'm going to close. Pandemonium can be a catalyst. Pandemonium. Believe it or not, the pandemonium can actually be a good thing if we respond properly. Pandemonium in the spiritual realm is good when it disrupts the plans of the enemy, when it stops him and creates chaos in his world. And I think that's happening. Pandemonium can be good when it exposes things like corruption or cancer or motives or evil that's going on. I pray that darkness is exposed. And I believe we're starting to see that, aren't we? Aren't we beginning to see motives? I pray that our eyes will be enlightened to see what God is doing and what he is exposing. By the way, here's a side note. If you are not in the Word and prayer and you are getting most of your information from social media or news outlets in the United States, you may think your point of view is always right, but you may not have it right. Don't be so sure. The devil masquerades as an angel of light, and God sometimes uses donkeys to deliver his message. So his message might come from a way that you don't think it's going to come. I pray that you spend time daily with Jesus in his word and talking to him so much that those voices don't matter anymore. The voices that matter are the voice that God tells you. God is using, I believe, pandemonium as a catalyst in the world to do some cleaning, resetting, and an opportunity to see his power and presence revealed throughout the world. How many of you believe that this morning? Let me close with this. Three ways to respond to this, and then we're going to sing a song. The spiritual tsunami, I believe, is taking place right now. It is cleaning, it is resetting, it is revealing God's power throughout the world. And I believe it's happening whether you recognize it or not. It's widespread, it's powerful, and it's unavoidable. You may be like the couple on vacation in the movie clip and relaxing, enjoying time in the pool or in your cabin. Here they are sitting on this resort, and God has other plans because a spiritual tsunami is coming. But here's the thing I know about God's word. Jeremiah 29:11 says, the spiritual tsunami, I'm going to relate it to the spiritual tsunami because the plans that God has through this, it says, are to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in a future. He has plans for restoration and rebuilding. He has plans for good. He has plans to give you hope in a future. So quickly, here are three ways to respond to a spiritual tsunami. Number one, get your life right with God. If your life is not right with God in the midst of the tsunami, make sure you have made it things right. As I said, we baptized in water 2 weeks ago three more people who wanted to publicly declare their faith in God to family and friends. And one a couple weeks before that, another one. If the end was near or if things got dicier in this country and in this world, do you know where you'd spend eternity? Do you know whose side you're on? You're either on God's side and you've accepted him as your Savior and Lord, or you're on the devil's side. There is no middle ground. My encouragement to you is that you would pray to receive Jesus today. It's very simple. It doesn't have to be a repeat after me or anything like this. It's basically you say, God, I'm a sinner, and I believe that you died for my sins. And so I confess that to you right now, and I accept you as my Lord and Savior. That's it. I'm going to live for you. If you need to make that decision today, I want to encourage you to do that. Matter of fact, let me stop for just a second. God, as we just, I just pray for anyone today that is not right with you. They could be adults, they could be kids, they could be male, they could be female, they could be rich, they could be poor. It doesn't matter. You died for all of us. And God, if there's anyone here or watching that needs to commit their life to Jesus 100%, maybe they've been riding the fence, but now today is the time they need to commit their life to you. I pray right now that they would do that. All it takes is a prayer in their heart saying, Lord, I admit I'm a sinner and I can't save myself. So I believe you died for my sins. And so I confess my sins to you right now. Would you come and be my Lord and my Savior? Lord, if there's somebody that needs to do that right now, Lord, I pray they would do that in their heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me give you two more quick things. Number one is you need to get your life right with God. Number two is hang on to the lifeline. During the spiritual tsunami, hang on to your lifeline. There's a song, a Christian song that I used to listen to called My God is a Rock. Here's how it goes. My God is a rock. There's nobody stronger. His ways and his means will last so much longer. My God is an ocean with love that runs deeper. My God is immortal. He is my keeper. My God is a rock. Psalm 18, verse 2 tells us this. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Hang on to the rock. He is your lifeline. Do you remember the old hymn? On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking ground. All other ground is sinking sand. Number one, get your life right with God. Number two, hang on to the lifeline. And number three, rejoice in what God is doing. I know this is a tough one because the world seems like the spiritual tsunami is wiping everything out, but God is doing something through it. Here's a devotional I read a few days ago that just hit me along these lines. It says, do not be dismayed at the shaking and stripping off of things from your life. Instead, rejoice. Rejoice because I am preparing for you. I am preparing you for what is to come. I need my people strong, full of hope, and filled with resilience. So my prayer for you in this rejoice what God is doing is, God, make me comfortable with holy chaos. That's not an easy prayer. But God, make me comfortable with holy chaos because you're doing something great. So here's what I want you to do. If you are ready to stand on the rock, and I'm going to ask the worship team to come up here because we're going to sing a song in a second. But if you're ready to either get your life right with God or say, I'm going to hang on to the lifeline who is Jesus, and I'm going to embrace the mess, I'm going to ask God to help me be comfortable with holy chaos, I'm going to have you represent by standing on the rock, by standing up. So if that's you here this morning, say, I'm going to stand on the rock of Jesus this morning. Would you stand up where you're at and pretend like you're standing on a rock and say, Jesus, I am standing on your rock this morning. In the middle of all that's going on, I embrace what's going on. And I believe this song that we're going to sing is powerful because it's talking about that spiritual tsunami. Sweep over my soul. Sweep over my soul. Sweet Spirit, sweep over my soul. The spiritual tsunami that's coming, Lord, I embrace that. My rest is complete while I sit at your feet. Sweet Spirit, sweep over my soul. So I'm going to switch microphones and we're going to sing that. Sweep over my soul, sweep over my soul, sweet Spirit. Rest. again as a prayer.
Sweep over my soul. Sweep over my soul. Sweet Spirit. Sweep over my soul. My rest is complete while I sit at your feet. Sweet Spirit. Sweep over my soul.
Here's how I want to close today, Lord. And God, we just come before you right now. And God, we thank you for your Spirit in this place. I pray, Lord, that we would embrace what you're doing. And we wouldn't fight it, Lord, but we would do the things that are needed, Lord, to say, not my will, but your will be done. Here's how I want to end. If you'd like to take some time and pray, I want to invite you to find a place to pray. Maybe it's at the front, or maybe it's where you're at. Just say, God, I know you're speaking to me, and here's how I'm going to respond. So I want to invite you to do that. If you're done, feel free to just slip out and allow the Spirit of God to take you places this week and embrace the mess. So God, as we just sit in your presence, we find a place of prayer today.